Sohrab Ahmari, it's so great to speak with you.
Thank you.
So, you know, a lot has happened in the last 48 hours. You have a blockbuster New York Post story that's come out, actually a series of stories about this hard drive that was recovered from a computer. A lot of very important reporting, seems like the provenance of which is known pretty well, but you've experienced some censorship. Why don't you quickly tell me what exactly happened?
So very quickly, we got hold of a hard drive that we believe belongs to a laptop that belonged to Hunter Biden. And it includes, as you imagine, a hard drive is a trove of information, but among other things, it includes emails that suggest or help explain why Hunter Biden, despite not being exactly an expert on Eastern European energy markets, was getting paid $50,000 a month at least to serve on the board of a rather shady Ukrainian energy company called Burisma. And it seemed that he had arranged meetings between a Burisma executive and his father while his father was vice president, the second most powerful man in the world, and playing an outsized role in the affairs of Ukraine. So we published this. We were very transparent about its provenance. We were very transparent about what we knew and what we didn't know. And we reported it out very meticulously. And then the morning we published it, we first heard from a Facebook communications director who also happens to have worked for Democratic lawmakers before joining Facebook, that they would reduce circulation of the story until there is fact-checking, which is unprecedented because there's at that point there had been no dispute about the factual basis of the story, and there still hasn't been. In other words, the Biden campaign hasn't come out and said, no, that's not our laptop or those emails aren't real or anything like that. So we've been, all we've been doing is telling our story, telling our reporting behind it. And today it seems like Twitter unlocked at least the initial Ukraine story. So now you can share it. And your viewers can find it anywhere. You can find it on our website, nypost.com. They can see for themselves both the kind of depth and quality of the reporting.
Yeah, I actually checked that about 5 minutes before we did this interview, and that first story about Ukraine is indeed unblocked, but the second story, which was about China connections, actually is not unblocked at this time.
Yes, and this just goes to show how much unaccountable power these tech monopolies wield, where our freedom of speech today lives or dies on these platforms. And, you know, So if freedom of speech is real and it matters, it has to be real on these platforms. And yet it's hostage to the whims of Silicon Valley billionaires, it seems.
So we have Jack Dorsey saying after all this censorship happened that Twitter did not communicate well. I believe that is the essence of what he said. Then subsequently, we have Vijaya Gadde, the legal policy trust and safety lead at Twitter, saying that they're actually going to be changing their hacked materials policy. Are there actually, well, for starters, are there actually any hacked materials in the story?
So to be clear, no, there isn't. I will just very briefly review what happened. Someone, again, we're not sure whether it was Hunter or not, and we've been very clear about that, but someone dropped off this laptop for repair at a laptop repair shop. Then they never picked it up, nor did they pay the repairman's fees. This repairman, as it happened, started looking at the material and saw that there were some interesting material on it. And so he alerted the FBI, but before giving the hardware to the FBI, he also made a copy. That copy went to Rudy Giuliani's lawyer, Bob Costello. Then we heard from Mr. Steve Bannon that there was such a hard drive. And then eventually we were able to procure that from, not procure, but to get it from Mr. Giuliani. That's, this is far more transparent than, for example, the sourcing of that Trump tax story. But the notion, to get to the philosophical issue here, the notion that the only types of stories that journalists can report are ones where the subject of the story wants to authorize it beforehand and gives permission that's contrary to the whole spirit of journalism, what you and I do. I mean, someone should tell Twitter about the Pentagon Papers. Someone should tell Twitter about the early turn of the 20th century muckrakers. All of journalism is disclosing things that powerful people don't want to see disclosed. Otherwise, what you're dealing with isn't journalism, it's public relations, if they want it released. So if this standard of unauthorized release is applied fairly, then the Trump tax story should also have been banned. The Steele dossier, which, by the way, turned out to be completely salacious and false, that should have been banned and censored. The story of the leaked calls of the First Lady, Melania, that came out just a few weeks ago, that was unauthorized release. That should have been censored. So it's very obvious that this is a one-way ratchet. These tools are only applied at only certain types of stories and certain types of subjects, and others are enjoying kind of perfect immunity.
So given that we're seeing some kind of shift on the Twitter side, at least, I mean, I think they're going to be putting up warning labels or something like this for content. Again, I don't have no idea how they're actually going to be judging this content. That's a whole different question, right? Well, actually, let me ask quickly about that. You know, there's this big question. Does this information, and this is kind of our take here at the Epoch Times, does the fact that this censorship, blatant censorship, happened actually... Are they admitting here that they've become publishers, both Twitter and Facebook, in this process?
You know, this is my opinion as a writer and an opinion editor, that these entities do not act the way that lawmakers imagined when they enacted Section 230, which is the governing law, that gives them immunity from the kind of liability that publishers like you or the New York Post or Fox News face, on the ground that they're sort of like bulletin boards. Yes, they can censor out obscenity and other kinds of extreme material or what have you, but nevertheless, even in doing so, the law doesn't treat them as publishers, but rather they're immune from liability, let's say, for libel or defamation. But now it clearly suggests that law that was enacted in the 1990s is not sufficient to the realities of today, because they're acting effectively like publishers. They favor narratives. In other words, Twitter, not only does it censor, but goes out of its way. If you open your Twitter app, there's a section that's like called Discover or something like that, where they promote their own choice of stories. And there's a clear editorial slant. So they published quote-unquote debunkings of our story that came from Washington Post. By the way, including blatantly factually false information. This debunking said that Joe Biden had never pushed for this Ukrainian prosecutor that was hounding his son's firm for being fired. He never pushed for him to be fired. Of course he had, because we have footage of Joe Biden saying proudly, boasting that I forced the firing of that prosecutor. But all of what I'm saying is, this is Twitter acting like an editor. It's acting like a newspaper. It's acting like a publisher. It has a worldview. And so it should be subject to the same liability that you, as at the Epoch Times, or we at the New York Post or any other publication faces. It's only fair if they're going to act like this.
So, and the FCC chairman, Ajit Pai, has... I don't know if this is by coincidence or, you know, by design, has also announced that he's moving for the FCC to actually interpret 230 and do some rulemaking around it.
It's most welcome. And in a way, it's quicker than legislation. Congress doesn't really legislate anymore, so who knows if we will ever come to see Section 230 reformed by lawmakers. So all of our lawmaking really happens by executive power or administrative action, and as an independent administrative agency, it seems like they believe they have the authority to render authoritative interpretations of what Section 230 really was meant to be. And so I welcome that action and Chairman Pai's courage.
Finally, just before we finish up, I wanted to quote you here. You said, this is what the new totalitarianism, or sorry, this is what totalitarian looks like in our century. This whole scenario in this op-ed that you wrote yesterday. I'd love to read the whole quote, because it's brilliantly written, but I'm wondering if you could just kind of explain. That's a serious charge.
Yeah, so I mean, when we think of totalitarianism, we think of these regimes of the 20th century, you know, Nazi Germany, Soviet Russia, the Iron Curtain. And in some ways, the Chinese regime today is old-fashioned, you know, pulling your nails and putting people in education camps in Xinjiang and so forth. Those exist, but there can also be a kind of more insidious, subtle totalitarianism that doesn't threaten you by driving a nail under your fingernail, driving a screw under your fingernail, but playing off of your preference for being comfortable, threatening your ability to have acceptance in your community or your having your job, or in the case of newspapers, getting out their reporting, just having this sort of subtly chilling effect may be sufficient. And in advanced Western societies, totalitarianism needn't take the form of, you know, 1984 boot on the face, torture and so forth, just much more subtle. And I'll give you an example. Following all this affair, a journalist, Jake Sherman, perfectly mainstream journalist, published this abject apology for having shared our story on his Twitter account. Oh, I should have read it more carefully before sharing it. I'm so sorry. Please forgive me. This sort of kind of confession, as though in a kind of self-criticism session. So what message does that send to other journalists? It sort of subtly signals that if you share stories that go against the narrative, you will be, you know, your account might be locked. You might be having to sort of confess. And so it brings about an atmosphere of conformity that's similar to the old type totalitarian regimes, and yet doesn't require the sort of bloody, gruesome torture methods or the gulag.
You know, this is really fascinating. When I saw that, I thought of two things. One was actually kind of exactly in the vein of what you're talking about, that we're seeing kind of a forced confession, which was forced subtly with the knowledge that if you don't do it, you will be so-called canceled or, you know, made radioactive or something like that. And the second part is that I was thinking actually about the Hong Kong national security law and its effect of sort of facilitating this self-censorship across a broad swath of both society within Hong Kong and here. And again, there's some parallels here that frankly disturb me deeply.
Yeah, likewise. And so we have to be extremely alert, courageous, vigilant, all of us who believe that democracy depends on freedom of information.
Well, Sohrab Ahmari, any final words before we finish here?
No, I just thank you for having me and thank you for following this story. And just again, I encourage everyone, because, you know, well, this will be my final word, that they're treating this as though it's some shady website that published this material. I encourage everyone to look at nypost.com, look at our reporting, judge it for yourself without letting the narrative be shaped for you before you've had a chance to read it. And remember, this is, you know, the New York Post was founded by Alexander Hamilton. It's the oldest continuously published newspaper in our nation's history. And so these new institutions, these Silicon Valley upstarts, really, truly, how dare they try to silence a voice like the paper founded by Hamilton?
Sohrab Ahmari, such a pleasure to have you on.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.